Good morning, Fontana. This is Ray Ebert.
This is Monique Carter.
And we're with the Fontana Unlocked podcast.
Good morning.
Good morning. Monique, real quick, I just wanted to mention that I noticed over the weekend that the Apple has decided to come into the modern era. They did add they converted from the Lightning port to the USB-C port on the iPhone 15.
Okay, so you know my angst with all of the charging issues. Now we have like 1,000,005 different charging ports for 1,000,005 different devices. This is very disconcerting to me.
Well, hopefully this will simplify things for you because it should match the charging that you have like maybe on your watch and other things. So I don't know. Anyway, I just wanted to, yay, Apple, welcome to the 21st century.
Well, did you notice the new iPhone 15, 17? Now there's another lens on the camera. So now there's 7 lenses on the camera.
We need more lenses. Yes. We need more cameras.
Because, you know, selfies need work.
I wanted to ask you actually a more serious question. So aliens.
Yes.
Are they here? Have they been here?
Okay. So I think they are here. But my concern is that, so me and the IT director, Jen, have had this conversation. She assumes that they're all nice. I don't assume that. I assume that they are here to take over. Like, why would everybody assume that they're here to learn from us?
Movie Aliens is the more accurate aliens for you, the
yes.
Armageddon and, you know.
Yes,
the,
yes.
I happen to disagree, and I'll apologize in advance, but I don't believe that they've been here. And I'm waiting for someone to convince me that they are, and I'm willing to be convinced. I haven't yet, but it's... I don't know if you saw a couple days ago that there was a gentleman who did a press release or a press conference in Mexico, and he showed us some papier-mâché ETs in a box. They were about, you know, a foot tall, and I'm really struggling. You know, that was the best you could do. You took a Steven Spielberg ET, you made a papier-mâché version, and you threw it in a box. I apologize if anyone, if I'm insulting anyone who does believe in those aliens. For me, it wasn't convincing. But I thought that the more interesting point was the fact that there's going to be some folks that are convinced by him and by that presentation. And there's some folks that are convinced by the Navy pilots and whoever else that are you know, going to Congress, and they're talking about here's the things that we're seeing as we fly over the ocean. And it kind of makes me think of conspiracy theories. The other thing that I was reading over the weekend was, do you recall a movement, Birds Aren't Real?
No.
That didn't make your,
no.
Hit your radar? Well, we won't get too deep into it, but there was a young man who several years ago started the, out of satirical effort, kind of making fun of some things going on several years ago, he made up this thing, Birds Aren't Real. And it got traction. The premise was birds were, between 1959 and 1971, all the birds were killed. All 12 billion birds, certainly in the United States, were killed. And they were replaced by drones with cameras. And they were surveillance drones.
Hmm.
When they, you know, for example, when birds are hanging out on the power lines, that's when they're charging. That's why they're up there sitting on the power line.
And this really gained traction.
It gained traction. It was articles in the paper. The gentleman was interviewed on 60 Minutes. It was obviously satirical, yet there were folks that either just bought in to the game and decided to go with it, or maybe some even believed it. And it was actually, do some research on it. I think it's a interesting read. I've been kind of stuck to it for a couple days.
I'm totally going to have to research it because for nothing else, the birds that are in my neighborhood have convinced me that birds are real. We have an issue with grackles. And so if you guys have ever looked up grackles in Texas, you will be very clear about what these birds do exist.
Absolutely. They actually drop a tracking fluid onto your car. One of the things that birds, that these drones do. It's a white fluid that then tracks you wherever you drive. So.
Hmm.
Yeah, birds aren't real.
So, I don't know. I mean, I recognize the whole, it's in line with kind of the alien conversation. I guess in my head, I was like, should I be so arrogant to think that we are the only species in, you know, in the galaxy? So, I don't know. I just in my head, that's where I go with it.
So that's an interesting point. I don't really want to get too deep into this, but there's a planet out there, an exoplanet that's... they've just called it Hycean. It rhymes with ocean, but Hycean. This planet, they think, is basically covered in water. It's about the size of about 2 or 3 times the diameter of the Earth. And They think it's liquid water like we have. There's a lot of different fluids out there in the world. You could have liquid nitrogen, for example. But this planet, they believe, is basically a water planet, a liquid water planet like we would have. And then they're detecting through the James Webb Space Telescope, which just went up last year, they're detecting carbon dioxide and a couple other chemicals that are traditionally found as a byproduct of life. So when I say I don't think aliens have been here, I don't mean to say that I don't believe that there is other life out there. And there's certainly, I believe that there's other intelligent life out there. I'm just struggling with the fact that maybe they visited us. But this is actually another interesting story where they you know, it blows my mind that this planet is you know, light years away, yet somehow through this amazing telescope we've put in into space, they're able to detect the contents of its atmosphere. Blows my mind. It's kind of cool.
Probably has an iPhone lens.
Or seven of them.
Yes. So what are we talking about today, Ray?
You know what? I might jump off a deep end here or go down a rabbit hole, the figurative rabbit hole. But so keep me on point. But we're going to talk about government today. We're going to talk about government from the highest levels in the United States, and we're going to actually get all the way down to Fontana City government. You kind of can't talk about the lowest part, and I don't mean that in a negative way, but you can't talk about the closest part to the residents without really talking about the entire thing, because the authorities and the responsibilities for every level of government kind of start at the top. So we're going to talk about government.
All right. So we're talking about government, but I don't want to be boring. We got to keep this lively.
Do my best. It's kind of one of those things. If you're interested in aliens, then a conversation about aliens is interesting. If you think that that's just the dumbest thing you've ever heard, it might turn you off. So I think government might fall into a bucket like that, and we'll try to keep it interesting. But it's an important topic. I think that it leads to other things that we're going to talk about down the line too.
Very much so. It's informative, and I think it's just a matter of the way that we explain it. I think will be
that's fair.
Make it interesting or not.
That's fair. I'll talk about the way the government killed birds. So the federal government. I think we're all aware that there is a federal government. There's a structure to the federal government. The federal government is defined by the U.S. Constitution, that was written back in the late 1700s by a number of folks. Thomas Jefferson, among others. And the federal government is, as per the Constitution, is defined into three pieces. You've got the executive branch, the legislative branch, and the judicial branch. The executive branch, I think everyone's aware, is the president. The president has some responsibilities and authority given to him or her by the Constitution. So then the next level down from the federal government is the state government. The state government, I found a quote from James Madison, which I kind of enjoyed, and I'll read it. The powers reserved to the several states will extend to all the objects which, in the ordinary course of affairs, concern the lives, liberties, and properties of the people and the internal order, improvement, and prosperity of the state.
And what does that mean?
The way I read it is basically anything that involves the folks, the people, the state's responsible for it. And there's a separate interpretation of this. Basically, anything that the federal government doesn't explicitly say is ours becomes the authority and responsibility of the state. So there's only certain things that the state's responsible for, and then everything else, that the federal government's responsible for, and then everything else is given to the state.
So effectively, the federal government is process, state government is people.
I think that's a great way to look at it. Absolutely. Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah. So the state and the federal government do have some overlapping responsibilities. States set up local governments. Many states have a constitution. They call it a state constitution, which is subservient to the federal constitution. The state can't establish laws that contradict the federal laws. And if they did, then they're going to go talk to the Supreme Court. The state's responsible for local marriages, or local licenses. So marriage licenses, driving licenses, hunting licenses. The state's work regulate commerce within the state. So intrastate commerce is managed by the federal government. Interstate or within the state commerce is established and responsible for the state is responsible for those things. So there's local state taxes, there's state excise processes. There's limitations on what you can do across state lines, for example. And within the state, then the state owns those responsibilities. There's a few other things that the state's responsible for. One is to support the public health of the citizens. And two is to administer education. So I wasn't aware of this. I know that my daughter, for example, has to take these state tests for when she in school to kind of gauge where she's at, and the schools are have to submit their roles, their attendance roles to the state to get make sure that they get the funding that they need from the state. And the reason for that is because that's been declared, legally declared, the state's responsibility, education, and the local the public health. So we hear, for example, our governor talking about the homeless and a lot of the mental health scenarios that are going on in the state. He's not doing that. There could be any number of reasons why he's doing it, but he's also mandated by law. The state is mandated by law to handle those types of responsibilities.
That falls within his responsibility realm.
Right, right. And so other things that the state does that are kind of similar to what the federal government does is they establish some courts. They do have some authority for taxing. They have the authority to borrow money and create banks. So those are kind of shared responsibilities between the federal and state governments. But they do it just locally for, you know, California wouldn't create a bank in Wyoming, you know,
or borrow
money and give it to Wyoming, or so, for example. At least I hope they would.
I was gonna say they don't need it. Wyoming is fine. We need it.
The next level down is the county government. And county, in at least in California, and so this is an interesting thing. Counties are implemented in different ways in different states, and some states don't even have counties. Louisiana has parishes, for example. Alaska, which we're going to talk about in a second, has a different kind of governmental structure. But in California, we have counties, and the county is kind of an extension of the state. So it's where the state has decided that it would be easier to manage certain types of things at the local level, as opposed to trying to do it from Sacramento, which is honestly a wonderful thing, because there are times when it feels, I don't know about how you feel, but sometimes it feels like Sacramento is not ever always aware of what's going on in San Bernardino County.
I'd say in Southern California is like, from my perspective, but yeah.
Right, right. So it's I think a good thing then that the state has decided to break up the state into counties. California has 58 counties, and there's some structure that's, again, legally mandated by the Constitution of California. So states, with a couple of exceptions, states or counties must have a board of five supervisors. I didn't realize that until recently, because cities, for example, can have any number of
right.
council members or representatives, but state counties in California must have five supervisors. Each supervisor must live in the district that they are representing.
Got it. So for Fontana, that little cutout over there by what was known as this, or what is known as the Speedway, is technically the county unincorporated, even though the people's address may say Fontana. That really is county jurisdiction.
That's right. And so the reason it says their address says Fontana is because their zip code is Fontana. Mm-hmm. And that's actually, the post office is actually run by the federal government. And they don't care about your counties. They just care about geographical areas. So
yeah. How do I get to your mail?
Yeah. So it's not, it can be confusing, and it's unfortunate, but that it's confusing. It's not unfortunate that it's not, incorporated Fontana, but... But yeah, the county is kind of independent of the cities. Some of the responsibilities that counties have, again, so this the managing of mental health, while and education are two really important ones. So while the state establishes kind of standards and says we're going to do these things from a policy perspective or from a strategic perspective, the implementers of those things are the counties. So county mental health, right? We have a facility not too far from here that's county mental health facility. You have local law enforcement that would enforce laws at the county level. So we have a sheriff. He's responsible for the county's law enforcement. School boards are generally implemented at a county level. So and they're independent, at least in California. Again, they're independent of the city. So the county says we're going to have these school districts, and they then manage if there's going to be a school commission or a school board. The county kind of manages those entities, and they're responsible for oversight and whatever else. A couple other things that the county is responsible for are weights and measures.
And what's that?
So every time you go to the gas, well, I'm sorry. When I go to the gas station, I don't think you would have.
I don't. Yes, I don't go to the gas station.
No, I know, but I don't think that your plug probably has a weights and measures sticker on it.
No, it does not.
Yeah. So when I go to the gas station, there's a sticker on the gas pump. And it basically, someone from the county went out there and measured that when you pull the handle, you know, pull the trigger on the pump and it says it's giving you a gallon, they actually go out and measure that and make sure that it is giving you an actual gallon of fuel. If you go to the grocery store, if you go to the grocery store and you buy a pound of oranges and you put them in the scale, there's a little sticker on the scale that says, okay, a pound on that scale is an actual legal pound, and it's been measured by the county, and they're saying, yep, that's a real pound. So all of those things, and there's all kinds of places. Meat, farming actually has a lot of measures that are important that need to be managed. So all of those weights and measures are managed at the county level. They're responsible for ensuring the accuracy of gauges and things like that.
So for all you kids who thought you weren't ever going to, there's no profession that you would use the weights and measures. There is an actual profession that, yes, you will use these things. That
absolutely.
You need to know what a gallon is and what an ounce is. So that's a thing.
And there may be a day that you might actually figure out what a kilogram is, or maybe you're going to figure out what a liter is.
I
don't know.
Now you're going too far.
Crazy.
Now you're going too far.
Sorry. Went nuts. The two other things I want to mention that the county is responsible for are elections. Mm. So they're the one. There's a registrar of voters who works at the county, and they're the ones that coordinate all the election boxes. We may be a collection point, for example, but we don't manage elections. If you go apply to run for office somewhere, then that application will actually end up at the county and they'll process that. The other thing that the county does is a recorder of documents. So if you have ever bought a home and you've tried to figure out where your grant deed was or who you paid your property taxes to, that's also the county. You get a letter from the assessor, and I think he's got like the longest title in all of government.
Yeah, assessor, recorder, tax collector. Yeah, it's a long one.
Right. Or if you get married, your birth certificates, all of those are held. Those documents are held at the county level, so they are responsible for all of those documents and processes. That's the county. San Bernardino. I want to real briefly mention that the San Bernardino County. Many of us have heard it's the largest county in the United States. It's the largest county geographically, so it's got the most space that it takes up in not just the lower 48. When I first read that, I thought, oh, it must be just the contiguous or the lower 48 states. No, it includes Alaska. And the reason is Alaska doesn't actually have counties. They have boroughs. Mm. So
is it like a semantics thing? It
is.
Oh, man.
So San Bernardino County is one of the largest in the entire United States, even if you include other types of, you know, boroughs or something. So we're about 20,000 square miles in size. That's larger than nine other states. Our mm-hmm. county is larger than nine other states. But Alaska has some very large boroughs. So they have some like 100,000, 120,000 square mile boroughs.
Wow.
But since they don't call them counties,
it doesn't count.
We're the biggest one.
So like if you're, just to give perspective, if you were driving from what, say, San Diego, like from San Diego County to almost Nevada, because we're up there where Needles is, that's all San Bernardino County.
That's also, well, I mean, on this side of San Diego County, yeah.
Yeah.
So from here to the state line, mm-hmm. And both state lines. So if you go to Yuma, or if you end up in Pahrump or whatever, going up towards Vegas, you're still in San Diego County or San Bernardino County. Or if you head up north, if you head towards Mount Whitney, for example, go up the 395, you're going to be in San Bernardino County for a very long time before you drop off into Kern County or Inyo or one of those other ones.
Oh, man.
It's a big place.
Yeah, we are.
So imagine then if you're, say, the sheriff. That's a lot of area to cover.
Yeah. That's like you need helicopters. This is not like we're going to take there's somebody needs to be arrested.
Right, right.
You're like, give me a minute.
I need
to get there.
It's a three-hour drive to get to where you got to arrest the guy. Like, I'll be right there. Give me a minute.
Well, give me a minute. Somebody get some zip ties on him.
That's right. And then after county, that's where we fall. That's where we come in. So cities, you used a word earlier. Unincorporated.
Mm-hmm.
Cities are generally incorporated. That's kind of how they become a thing. And that word is actually a common word outside of government too. So your most of your companies are incorporated. It's you file letters of incorporation, you have shareholders. So it's a very similar process to become an incorporated city as it is to becoming a corporation, an incorporated business. We had to declare, you know, there's a bunch of legal processes that the city had to go through back in, what was it, 1958 or, sorry if I got that
wrong.
Oh,
1952.
52, sorry.
Yes, that's when we were incorporated as a city.
So the city decided to incorporate, and that's a voluntary process. The counties are mandated by the state. The states are defined at the federal level and are allowed to join the United States. The federal government is defined by the Constitution, but at the city level, we can decide to be a city or we can decide not to be a city. And that's actually happened. So there's a few cities who have decided to decorporate or basically let their letters of incorporation fail or end or whatever the process is. They decided they don't want to be a city anymore. They just want to be a part of the county again. Frankly, luckily that hasn't happened here. But so cities are a voluntary entity. They just choose to become this legal entity called a city. And so therefore, because it's voluntary, there's a lot more autonomy. There's a lot more flexibility at the city level than there is, say, at the county level. So counties are required to have five supervisors or five board supervisors. Cities can have any number of types of representatives, and there's a whole bunch of different types of government structures that are applicable to cities. And it's up to the city how they want to, what type of government structure that they want to incorporate with. We'll talk about those in just a second, but there's the responsibilities that the city can take, or they kind of share it with the county. And so there's kind of a negotiation process. And so some of the things that cities can take on would be to levy taxes, which in the state of California always require a ballot measure. The public must approve any new tax. Mm-hmm. Local ordinances, generally dealing with property ownership. So all of the zoning laws are generally responsible. The responsibility lies at the city level. Local fire and police can be the responsibility of the city, and I'll come back to that in a second. Utilities, sanitation, public transportation, parks generally are a city entity generally, but there's also county parks as well. Public housing, these are things that cities generally take responsibility for, but they work with the county. Those are all things that are generally that the county is responsible for. But once the city decides to incorporate and take on some of this, they work with the county. We would work with the county and decide, okay, how are we going to handle these responsibilities? Who is going to be the police or the fire representative in, say, Fontana?
It sounds like when a city becomes a city, it almost takes a load off of the county. They're like, oh, thank God, you take care of that.
It really does. Yeah, it really does. And the city can take ownership of that. And so back to the concept of the having the entity that's closest to the service receiver, so the public, having that entity run those types of responsibilities, they're more aware of what their local residents need and want. They have a closer relationship with their residents, so they have a better understanding of how to provide the services that the residents might want. So I think there's an operational benefit to having a city, for example, provide fire and parks, mm-hmm. than the state and even the county. Again, we're talking about the largest county in the United States. So it definitely offloads some responsibility for the county, and they're like, "Yeah, you go take care of that. I got to go up to Inyo.
I'll be in Needles for a little bit."
That's right. The city can deliver these services through any number of mechanisms. The city can choose to deliver the services internally. So, for example, in Fontana, we have a police department, and we chose to do that. But if you go to Rancho, their police department is actually provided to them by the County of San Bernardino. So they have contracted with the sheriffs, San Bernardino sheriffs, for police services in the city of Rancho Cucamonga. We decided to establish our own police department, so we have our own officers, and they all are City of Fontana employees.
Shout out to Chief Jorsey.
That's right. But fire, we're a contract city when it comes to fire. So we contract with San Bernardino County Fire to provide our fire services. So my point being, these services that the city chooses to deliver can cross any number of ways of doing that. You can contract out with another agency like the county, or you could contract out with another agency that's like a private company. For example, Fontana Water. That's a private company. They provide the water services for a significant portion of Fontana. that's not us. We don't do water. We don't really do any utilities. So electric is from Edison and so on. So,
okay, so let's repeat that. Electricity is from Southern California Edison. So if there is a power safety shutoff, I need you to call Southern California Edison.
That's absolutely, yeah. I mean, we can try to facilitate, but we have no. We have really, you know, it's a different private company. We have no way to influence them, really.
Sorry.
So those are some of the ways that local governments provide these services. And then I mentioned governmental structure. So there's actually a bunch of different ways that cities can choose to incorporate. And I'll mention one, and then we're going to circle back to it. So the most common local government structure is the council manager form of government. So pocket that for a second. We're going to talk about, just so that folks are aware that there are actually other ways that cities can choose to govern themselves. The second most common way is called the council, council mayor council form of government. And you'll see this in very large cities. Los Angeles has a council mayor form of government, Boston, Houston. And this is basically where the elected council and mayor have day-to-day responsibility, operational responsibility for the city. So the Mayor Bass over in Los Angeles, she goes to the city every single day. She's a full-time employee of the city. There's a lot of appointed positions in this type of government because, for example, she might appoint a homeless czar and she might appoint a crime czar and so on. And so that form of government, those elected officials are there every single day and they're running the city on a day-to-day basis. That's an important distinction to make.
So do they have a city manager then?
They sometimes do. Some of them will hire a professional manager to run the administrative piece of the city. So there's where, and so the council might establish policy and they might even be strategic and a little bit tactical in how they perform activities, but they might bring in a professional manager to handle the finance department, the IT department, public works. And so some of the administrative pieces. And that's up to the city whether they choose to do that or not. But generally, the day-to-day operational responsibilities fall to the elected officials. A couple of others. There's a commission-style form of government where the residents vote for commissioners, and each commissioner takes on a responsibility. So you might vote for a fire commissioner. You might vote for a police commissioner, a public works commissioner. And so those then commissioners are they're voted in. They're elected officials, and they have operational responsibility for that piece of city operations. Mm-hmm. These are generally older cities or smaller cities that do this type of form of government, and it's not too common in California.
I was going to say, I don't know any, at least in the IE, I'm not familiar with any.
Yeah. These other two, I would be terrified of working in this environment. But back east, and this is mostly like in maybe, Boston and Maine and some of the smaller, older cities that were established in the early 1700s, for example. So there's two types of forms of government out there being used. One is called the town meeting. Basically, everybody just gets together, they go to the town hall, and they all decide collectively as the residents, almost like an HOA, where we're going to do this and they try to make decisions as a collective body.
I wonder how effective that is.
Yeah, it's an active form of government. I have the same question. Gosh, how do you make a decision with 1,500 people in a room?
I can't even ask my kids what we're having for dinner. They all have different answers.
Yeah. And then a very similar form of government to that is called the representative town meeting, where it's almost like a mini version of the House of Representatives, where the public, the residents, vote for a large number of representatives. So it might be, say, 100 residents vote for one town meeting representative, and so they end up with, say, 50 representatives instead of 1,500. So it's a little smaller group of folks, fewer voices in the room, but still, we're a family of three plus two dogs, and we have a very difficult time picking the movie we're going to go watch. So I don't know how you make decisions at this level, but there are a few cities that seem to manage to work through it.
Interesting.
Yeah. I know we're getting a little bit long here, but we're now going to talk about the form of government that Fontana uses. This is the most popular form of government in the United States for cities above 2,500 people. Other than large cities, this is the predominant version of government for local government, and it's called the council manager form of government. And this form of government's been around since about 1908. It started in the Midwest in Ohio, and it got popular from there. It's actually popular in the United States. It's popular in Ireland, New Zealand, and Canada. Interesting. I found it interesting that those were the four countries where this particular form of government is very common. But they all, even though they're very different countries, they all implement this form of government in a very similar way. So the structure is the council or the council and mayor are effectively very similar to a board in a private corporation. So you've got a board that decides policy in a private corporation. They hire a person that they usually title the CEO or chief executive officer. And that chief executive officer is then responsible for implementing the policy or strategy that the board establishes. Council manager is exactly the same from that perspective. So the council and mayor establish policy. They decide in what direction, what's the flavor, what's the personality
priorities
and culture of this entity. The city manager is our CEO. They hire a city manager, and then his or her responsibility is to go implement that policy and those strategies. The council and manager, the council and mayor have, they're responsible for appropriations. So if there's any way that the city makes money, those methods must be approved by the council. If that government, say Fontana, spends money, the spending of that money must be approved by city council. So they have the very high level strategic policy level decision making has the responsibility lies with the council. Implementing all of that then, in our case, falls to the city manager, Matt Ballantyne, and so it's his responsibility then to go and implement those policies. So the city council, in our case, they have hiring and firing authority of three folks, or two folks, and kind of a dotted line. So the city council has two employees effectively. They have the city manager and the city attorney. Both of those folks report directly to the city council. Our city council also has approval authority over the hiring of the chief of police. All other staff report to the city manager. You and I report directly to the city manager, and he has the responsibility for the organizational structure and responsibilities and division of responsibilities within the city.
Really, effectively, Matt is the CEO of Fontana.
Absolutely, yes.
He's kind of got to know a lot about a lot.
He does, and that's a great point. So what his responsibilities are actually called out in our municipal code. I mentioned our municipal code before, but it's our law. So our municipal code declares who has responsibility for what, and if you were to go read that very riveting document, you'll learn what Matt's responsibilities are. In addition, sometimes his contract might have some additional responsibilities or authorities that he might be given. But within that structure, it's his responsibility to run the day-to-day business. He needs to be very communicative with the council. He needs to feed back to them how are we doing, right? So the council sets the goals. Matt then is responsible for implementing the goals, and then he tells them, hey, this is how we're doing. And so that's why we have, for example, just on Tuesday night, we had a financial report from our CFO. The reason we do that is because we have to tell the council how we're doing. And they are responsible for responding to that if, say, this isn't what the situation is, but if we're short on funds, we don't have enough money to get through the rest of the year, the council is the one that's going to determine, all right, how are we going to bridge that gap? Are we either going to bring in more money through some mechanism, or are we going to just spend less through some other mechanism? So that responsibility falls with the council, but we have to tell the council how we're doing so that they can make educated decisions.
So something comes to mind that seems very interesting to me. Matt effectively has five bosses.
He does.
Oh, that's
yeah.
Intense.
Yeah.
That's intense. Hats off to you, Matt.
Yeah. And there's some structure in our municipal code as to how those decisions are made. So I think we have to have a minimum of a simple majority on the council to approve things. So if the budget's going to be approved, in our case, we have five, four council members and a mayor, there has to be a 3-2 vote to pass anything, as long as there's a quorum. So he has five bosses. He has to get at least three of them to agree to get anything going. And you know, we actually have a great council. So more often than not, we're a 5-0 or a 4-1 type vote. And so they're very supportive of staff. They're very supportive. As long as we are implementing the things that they feel is most important for the residents of Fontana, they are then supportive of us. And it's actually, to this point, it's been a great relationship.
I agree. I feel like there's a lot more that we could dig into with regard to kind of the CEO responsibilities and those kinds of things. But I recognize now we are getting long in time. So should we table this for kind of a part two conversation to kind of dig into some of that?
I think we should. I think that there's a whole conversation to be had just on the city manager.
Maybe we'll convince him to come on.
That'd be great. Yeah,
we'll see.
But yeah, I think we've hit a time we should probably kind of turn this down a little bit.
So, any final thoughts? Closing thoughts?
That was a lot, right? So my first comment is, if anyone out there heard something that they want us to drill into deeper, let us know. Leave us a comment, send us an email, send us a 311 message, because we just unpacked literally the entire structure of government in 40 minutes. So if there's something we need to talk more about, please let us know. If you are looking for a place to find us, all of the podcast engines should list us, even the Apple one. There's Google Play, there's Spotify. Go find wherever you consume your podcast. That's where you're going to find us. I think that's about it.
All right. This was Fontana Unlocked. We've had fun. I'm Monique Carter.
And I'm Ray Ebert.
I want to give credit where credit is due. Recording was done in KFON Studios here in Fontana, California. Shout out Media Services. Sound recording and engineering was done by Albert Sita. Production was done by Oliver Galvez, Francisco Vega, and Brandon Alcantar. Research and fact-checking done by the illustrious Cecilia Lozano and Ashley Martin. Thank you very much. We'll see you next time.